Thank you, John.
Use this one. I'll use that one. Okay.
Thank you, John. Oh, that's better. So, I have a confession. Well, let's start by saying who I am. He's done that most of it already. So, I actually weirdly enjoy working on really large Scala code bases. I really enjoy the challenges and opportunities that provides. So, it's interesting. If you've ever worked on a code base larger than a million lines, hands up. Oh, quite a few. I can guess where you work. Using Scala. So I love JVM, which is quite a lot of fun if you've never done it. It's part of my research. And I'm an enzyme called committer. And I now call myself an itinerant optimizer. So I have a bad habit now of randomly interjecting myself into projects and making things a bit faster. So I thought, oh, do the same for the Scala compiler. So, confession time. If you read the description of the talk in the program, I'm not giving that talk at all. So I started looking at Kentucky Mule. It is quite a lot of fun. It will get you very drunk very quickly. This is how you make it. I'm not going to talk about kamikazes either. That was a running joke in the title, but it doesn't make sense now. The reason is, basically, I got into playing with actual performance of the Scala C compiler, and I came across some interesting stuff there, and I thought that was actually more interesting to talk about. Kentucky Mule has some interesting facets. It's an interesting attack on the compiler performance, and I do want to come back and visit that again, because I think some of the techniques that Greg showed are actually relevant to what we're doing. But that's not going to be this talk today. So if you want to leave now, please just quietly. So the first thing we need to clear up is, when I say you want the Scala compiler to be faster, what do you actually mean? Now, who here uses SBT? Everybody. That's good. That's a good start. IntelliJ? So which do you care more about, SBT being fast or IntelliJ being fast?
Both.
IntelliJ.
Both.
SBT.
I run SBT next to my IntelliJ because it's faster than IntelliJ.
Right. Oh. So my point here is the fact that it very much depends on what you're doing with these tools, what you actually mean by faster and where your pain point is. So plain old Scala C, very few people actually run plain old Scala C on its own. John probably does, because he runs everything from Bash, so we'll let him do that. But the rest of us either run SBT projects or run IntelliJ. So SBT projects, single module builds, that's great. When you work on a project with 50-odd modules and huge amounts of dependencies, that's a different beast in and of itself. And then you've got the whole incremental and IDE builds, and those vary as well, and there's some other stuff going on. So let's quickly cover how you make things faster. This is not rocket science, and you should all know this. There will be a test later. No, I don't mean. So
yes.
Do less work. Yes, you knew that one. Excellent. It sounds stupid, but it's true, right? That can be, I can't actually read my slides, that's a good start, isn't it? So doing less work, so dividing your project, if you've got a large single code base, into multiple modules, so you're only compiling one part of it, that will make things faster for your day-to-day work. You know, clean out your project, think about your build organization. Less effort per unit of work, so this is per module or per class file or whatever, so that can be two levels. In terms of the compiler, it can be micro-optimizations, so making a single method faster, or it can be macro-level optimization, so rethinking how you do things. Stuff like the work on implicits that's currently in PR'd in the Scala compiler. And do more work at the same time. I don't know about anybody else, but I sit there with an SBT build and the system monitor running, and I have 12 cores on my machine and one of them's running 100%. That doesn't feel very useful. The other interesting note is keeping the CPU pipeline filled, and this is much more about compiler writers than you as a program author. But one of the interesting things that came out of Dottie is Dottie's tree traversal, because it keeps things much more localized, keeps the caches hotter, the CPU caches. And what that means is, whilst they do about the same amount of work and the same amount of JVM instructions, their stuff runs about twice as fast. And just think about that for a moment. So literally, I've got the same physical number of JVM instructions, the same amount of logical work going on, and it's running twice as fast. So can we leverage off of that? Yes, but that comes down to macro level organization, and that stuff's hard. And don't redo work you've already done. And that comes back to some of the talks you're going to get tomorrow. So what's the compiler doing? So this is a breakdown of all of the phases within the Scala compiler. And for anybody that's ever looked at this stuff before, type is at the top. And typer is the big beast in the room. So this is a compiler of the Akka Actor module from the Akka project, because it's a nice, it's a medium size, relatively complex project. So it's a nice standalone test. And it's the one I've used for all the benchmarks you'll see later on. The other ones that are interesting is the JVM phase. So the JVM phase is the one that is actually converting the trees into bytecode and actually creating class files. So my point here is, actually, we're going to come back to this, but if I speed up tail calls, even if I make it infinitely faster, you're not even going to notice. So if I'm going to focus on anything, it's got to be typer. And as you'll hear shortly, somebody else has been hacking on typer as well. So there are two other compiler performance talks going on this session. So, and they're both going to be really interesting, and hopefully they're going to prove that, you know, they can do better than I can. So we'll see. So Julian and Mirko's talk about Hydra, and Christoph's talk about Dry and the incremental compiler, they should be really fun. I'm really looking forward to them. So I'm not going to go into what Hydra does, because there's people in the room who can do a significantly better job than I can. So go to that talk straight after and learn lots about what they're doing and how well they've done. And I'm actually really looking forward to how well they've done from the hints I've heard and from their previous talk. So it should be really fun. And Christoph's talk about using incremental compiler artifacts, so you don't redo builds when you don't redo work when you switch branches and things. So that's quite an exciting thing. So again, this is when you think about performance of what you actually mean and what you care about, it's not simply about making Scala C faster. It's the entire tool chain. So how are we doing as a community? Actually, when I started playing with compiler performance, I was actually, you know, I felt like a lone person in the wilderness. And actually, I realized the fact that's not true. There's a lot of people care deeply about this stuff. If you look at, just look at Scala, there's a huge amount of work going on, a huge amount of interest, and there's lots of stuff going on. There's the inductive implicits work for certain projects. That's going to make stuff hugely faster. The other things that are coming is that if you're going to introduce a speed up in the immutable map in Scala now, one of the things you'll be asked to do is provide a benchmark. And there's a benchmark tool built in the Scala C code base that you can run to actually prove that you're making things better. So that means hopefully less regressions. And on exactly that note, Lightbend, very soon now, are going to be releasing a Scala performance benchmark. So every PR, every time somebody commits, you'll be able to see the effect of that change on performance. And some changes may be make the performance worse, but at least we're aware of the fact that it gets worse, and we've chosen to do that in that for that individual case. As I said, the inductive implicit stuff is also really exciting. This is Miles's original graph. I'm actually going to be talking about being an itinerant optimizer, I'm going to be spending some time working with a profiler to try and get some more performance out of some of the steps in that shortly. So how am I doing? How have I done in the past 3 months since I gave a talk about making the Scala compiler 10 times faster? So unfortunately, 10 times faster would be 90% there, not 6. Sorry. But I'll take 6. 6 is better than 0, so, you know, it's good. So the two parts are, the interesting parts are, it is a load of micro-optimizations. A load of those are already merged into the Scala mainline, and they'll be released in 2.12.2. And some parallelization within the bytecode generation, because bytecode generation is each, all the bytecode, all the classes are basically independent, so you can generate them at the same time. I will do, yes. The slightly depressing part is this is about 4 and a bit percent. And after 3 months' work, so this took like 4 days recently, and suddenly things got 4% better. This has taken 3 months, and I've made about a one, you know. Apparently the low-hanging fruit was somewhere else. It's if you've ever done optimization at scale, you always find the thing you think is the right answer is always the wrong one. You'll spend months looking at various things, and you'll be like, oh, it won't be that, but I'll put that change in anyway, and suddenly everything's better. Yeah, that's just slightly depressing, really. So who here uses a profiler like YourKit, JProfiler? Wow. I'm actually really impressed. I used to ask that question, there'd be one lone hand sort of gently. So a quick note on your profiler. If you haven't read this paper, go and read this paper. It'll tell you how badly your profiler is lying to you. One of the problems with profilers is profilers have things called save points, and you'd learn a lot about that reading this paper. And they're also, the thing I've found with profilers is they tend to be focused. You get a very narrow view. You either get a very wide view, which doesn't give you enough information about where something's happening, or a very, very narrow view, because you've done a complete CPU trace of this chunk of code, but you can't run a complete CPU trace across even a tiny Scala C project. It will blow your profiler out of memory or blow your system out of memory. It doesn't work. So you end up profiling really slivers and trying to work out what the hell's going on based on 5 seconds of profiling. And the problem you find is, if you think back to the phases thing, which 5 seconds you pick really matters. So there are some good tools. They're very hard to use. Has anybody used Oracle VTune? One. Well done. It does some very, so you, with VTune, you can actually look right down to the bytecode, the JIT, the actual CPU instructions. But again, it's very good when you're trying to optimize why you've got cache misses on a single function. But it's very hard to say, how do I make Scala C bit better? Benchmarks. There is actually a benchmark framework in Scala C now, which is really useful. It is quite powerful. Benchmarks are hard. It's very hard. It's very easy to benchmark something. If you're saying, so one of the changes I put into Scala C was map.contains. Map.contains used to be implemented as map.get.isDefined, which creates an option every single, a sum every single time you call it. Which is a horrible, in terms of performance, it's horrible. But the truth is nobody calls contains in Scala because that's not the way we write code. We always write x.getMatch blah, right? So you don't actually notice, whilst in the benchmark it looks really good, it's like 50 times faster, in reality it makes no difference to any project you care about. So one of my bugbears is GC. And one of the bugbears with functional programming is garbage. Good functional code often spews garbage like it's going out of fashion. So I have a list of X, I do list.map to get an int out, and then I do dot max, so I create an entire list of boxed ints. And it's even worse if you do doubles, because you fully box the doubles. It's really fun. So my point is, garbage is one of those things that has a hidden cost. You don't see it in your code. You don't think about it in terms of the work your program's doing. But behind the scenes, obviously, if you've ever had a program that's spewing garbage and running out of memory and doing full GCs and your program is stalling, you'll really see it. But somewhere between those two is what you're normally running. They cause second-order effects. At the point of allocation, allocation costs almost nothing. The reason is it's done, the thread has a local memory buffer, a TLAB, and that's very cheap. It's updating a memory pointer. But what happens is once it gets tenured, you've got your garbage collection cycles, you've got all sorts of stuff going on. So it's all second-order effects, and where your performance hurts may not be where you're actually generating the noise. So why is profiling Scala C hard? It's a big code base, it's complicated, it does a lot of work, and it does, as I was saying before, a lot of varied work. So the things you see, where you're profiling, if you're profiling the JVM phase, obviously it's generating bytecode, it's generating byte arrays, it's doing all sorts of that kind of work. Nowhere else in the code base does it do that. So the interesting thing is, what can we capture? And we've made some changes here, which is what I'm going to talk about next. When you're doing profiling with a profiler, you tend to get a very narrow view of the thing you're looking at. You can either, as I say, deep dive into one very specific bit, and actually even doing that on the compiler, trying to capture what's happening in Typer without extras is quite fiddly. Or you instrument, you put print statements in, you generate login statements, you capture the timings, but it's a very wide view, right? It doesn't give you all the things. So we added some features. So this is going to be committed or PR'd into the Scala code base shortly. Some extra profiling hooks. So the first one allows you to capture phase-based profiling, so timings and allocations, which is something I consider important, and GC activity. So this allows you to start breaking down that code. And the second flag here allows you to throw it into a CSV file, and then we can post-process it to do deeper analysis. This flag, external tools, is a hook to allow you to attach your profiler to a given phase. So there's hook methods on the start and end of the phase that get called on the phase you've targeted. So with YorkIt and JProfiler, you can actually say, start profiling at this point in time. When you see this method invocation, start profiling, which is a really useful way of then profiling Typer, for example, or JVM, or whichever phase you're interested in. And actually, a lot of the work I've done recently has all been based off of that. I can start to focus on things I care about and where I think the time is, rather than doing these sort of global pick and choose optimizations. And I can force a GC between each cycle to try and get a better idea of how much garbage and things different phases are generating. The reason is you need a harness. You've got to be able to run this in an automated fashion. The most fun thing, and we'll come to why that is in a minute, is what I would tend to do is I would make a small change. I would run my new version of the compiler up, and it'd be 20% faster.
Yes.
Big win, right? Yay. Made a small change. I can see the difference. I can see the difference on the wall clock. And then you'd run it again, and it's gone. So I'd make another change. Yay, it's better. Run it again, it's gone. That was fun. Because I really thought in the first 3 or 4 weeks when I started playing with Scala performance tuning, I was like, I find something to generate a lot of noise, and things would be better. And then I would run it again, and it wouldn't be anymore. Who has used Ammonite? Oh, a few. Less people than used a profiler. That's interesting. Ammonite scripts are a really nice way of writing harnesses around things, if you haven't done it, because it's got all the I.O., all the low-level system stuff. And I just found it a really fun way of doing stuff. And I will share this stuff, all this harness stuff, once I've tidied up and it's not quite as hacky as it is now. So what do you get? This is what you get out of the profiler tool with the console logging for phases. So what you can see is for namer, we've got the wall clock time, the CPU time, user time, and allocated bytes. There's actually a hook in one of the Sun MX beans. You can actually get the number of allocated bytes if you're using the Sun JVM and get useful information out. And it's actually a really fun stat to watch. If you dump it to file, you get a nice parsable CSV. So obviously, it's not very exciting looking at a CSV file. So what are the observations? I said before, every time I made a change, I thought I'd found something big. And the reason is, if you type SBT++ your build on a build you've just done and time it, my results show that typically the first run out of 25 will be about 35% faster than subsequent runs. Yeah, exactly. Eugene pointed out exactly. It's like, what? That doesn't make sense. And this... Dale is taking all the credit for that, apparently. So actually, we had a conversation outside earlier, and some of the guys gave me some insights into why this might be, because this totally baffled me and totally throws your numbers, because your delta between your worst and your best case is like 35%. But it's only ever the first run. So what actually happens, the first time you run SBT with a new compiler, it goes, oh, I'm going to compile some compiler interfaces for you and do a whole load of other work. And that part, so my first test wasn't very clean, right? I accept this in hindsight. But what it did is it got, oh, it's a new compiler. I'll run compiler interfaces. I'll warm up the JVM nicely. And I'm still not entirely sure why it's that much bigger, but your first run, in my case, was significantly different. Right? This is, you know, I haven't seen a change that big. You know, I talk about 1% and 2% changes, and so this is exactly what I'm seeing. The first time I made a change and ran it, I got really good numbers, and I had to rerun it two or three times, and the numbers would disappear. So I'd exit SBT and run it. So each time I'm running SBT from cold. It's the JIT warming up. It's also loading class files, all that kind of stuff. So there's a whole bunch of stuff going on, but I hadn't even considered it when I first played with that. Yeah.
That's one run.
Yeah. So 25 runs of SBT compile from the command line, effectively. Okay. The interesting... Yeah, sorry.
Trying to compile something else, some else product, and this percent is also so high?
Not recently. I've been... So it's a classic way of a talk, is you plan what you're going to run right for months, and then a week before the talk, you find something new and something exciting. And I haven't done all of those due diligence stuff.
Yeah, I just was interested whether it's so high value for some small project.
So it might not be so high on a small project. So this was Acroactor, which is like 200 classes, I think. So it's a teen-sized project. But yeah, I haven't gone through the due diligence of working out all the why this is and what it, but the implication is obviously you want a warmed JVM, so don't restart SBT. Mirko?
Does that mean that on the CI we should probably get rid of the compiler interface, because it would actually speed up single compilation on the CI?
No, it's the other way around. What you want to do is you run your CI with a new compiler every time. So it's only the first run with a new compiler that gets this benefit. But that's really interesting, right? Because it's really interesting because it means a warmed JVM, even on a compiler that takes 25 plus seconds, has a significant impact on subsequent work. So in fact,
are you cleaning between each run?
Yes, in a separate thread, in a separate execution. So the clean's not part of the build. Dale.
Just for clarity, you're measuring the time of compilation, not the whole SPT.
I'm measuring just the time, the total time of the phases using the data that I'd output. So it's not right. it's not the wall clock time of the
right.
The
so
SPT
the
process.
Extra time of compiling the compiler phase, the compiler interface.
Is not included in the
right.
timings.
Just for clarity.
Yeah. So to clarify that for the audio, I'm not compiling the times that I've captured are purely the computation of my target project. So not the actual time of the SPT warm-up, the SPT load, and whatever else the compiler interface compiles. But it's just the actual target times of the phases I'm interested in. The interesting thing is, even with exactly the same code base, though, you see up to 8% variance in the wall clock time, in the various CPU times. So the effectively the wall clock time and the user times, and a 5% variance in the allocations, which I've yet to explain. But I would have assumed that Scala C would actually be very consistent about the total amount of work that it's doing, and I've yet to fully understand that. There's a bunch of stuff. It could be jitting, kicking in earlier or later. It could be various other plays, and I haven't got to the bottom of that yet. So that's my next challenge. So these are the changes that are in the Scala compiler based off of this work so far, and there are more coming. Map.contains contains boxing around depth. So one of the things we saw a lot of is boxing in various cases, obviously often easily removed. So filter and filter not and map conserve are really interesting implementations. Because from a purely functional point of view, or from an execution point of view, they do exactly the right thing. So map conserve, if the list is unchanged after you've done the map operation, then it will return you the original map. It won't return a copy of the map, which obviously reduces your memory pressure. But the original implementation would always create you a new map, or always create you a new list. It would then throw it away, but it would create the list first. So it obviously generates n allocations for a list of n size, which is, you know, churny. And that puts GC pressure and all the rest of it. Symbol marking, an array slice defaulted to some higher level collection. So array slice defaulted to the default collection implementations of taking n bytes from the front of an array, so it would do an iteration. It would do an iteration and build a new list in the worst possible way. So one of the fun things about performance, especially in the Scala compiler relies heavily on the default collections classes, and the default collections classes have significantly variant performance characteristics. They will be functionally correct, but they will vary highly in how they perform, especially with regard to temporary object creation. I got the wrong title on there. So, in total, with these changes and a bunch of other minor changes I got from the recent profiling, there is about a 10% saving in total garbage in Typer, which I think is quite significant. The really frustrating for me is once I actually captured once I got some sensible looking timings, it turned out I made about a 1% difference to the actual wall clock time, which is really frustrating. So, as I say, with an 8% variance between runs, it's actually very hard to even notice a 1% difference. So I've really been struggling. And actually the biggest challenge for this has been to actually work out how to capture whether or not we're actually making a difference. Because all of the changes I'm making, I'm not expecting to be a 10% difference. I'm expecting there to be a 0.1 here, a 0.1 here, lots of small changes. And in the last week or so, we've got another about 1% by removing mutable settings. So mutable settings are great, they're very flexible, but every time you ask, in the Scala 2.12 compiler, is it Scala 2.11? There's still a whole bunch of checks to say, is it Scala 2.11 in the Scala 2.12 code base? That actually does a lot of work, and at one point actually does a regex. So, yeah. No, it's not a val. it's checked every single time. Yeah, so you know, whilst during your run of SPT, it's mutable because it could be changed by, you know, you could update a setting or whatever. So it's doing a whole lot more work than. So there's two changes here. One is to take out some of the checks you don't no longer need, and the other one is to move some of those settings into an immutable set of settings. So for a given compilation run, obviously the settings aren't going to change. So you can take a defensive copy, use that copy, turn them all into vals, everything works faster. So that will go in shortly, probably next week. As I was saying, the biggest change I've actually been part of is parallel bytecode generation. So bytecode generation done at the end, if you think about it, it's inherently parallelizable. But at the moment, it basically.
How many cores do you have
there? I think I was running with 4. So it's not that. This is recent stuff, and I haven't actually played with all the variants of it, and I haven't actually profiled it in detail. So I'm hoping, and I honestly believe there's significantly more performance improvements within that phase. And some more parallelization that can be done. This is the first cut of that work. And because it's 25% faster in that phase, which is the second biggest phase, you actually have a noticeable difference on the compilation time, which is really nice. So it's one of those things, as I said, it's you always find the performance in the places you're not actually looking and often not working. So. So that's how we've done. It's okay. I wish I'd done better. So I've got a little challenge for you guys. So here is depth. Depth is used inside the compiler whilst you're doing type stuff. And there is a significant memory churn in this method, in specifically max. Can anybody tell me what it is? Sorry, I'm standing in front of it. It all looks pretty good, right?
You have to create a comparator every time to compare this with that instead of comparing the depths.
So you don't create a comparator because you're implicitly using the because it is ordered. To give you a clue, that's the fixed code. So original, fixed. So when it calls the compare method, it boxes the two values it's already got to use compare on it to do the less than. So in the profile I was using, that created about 80,000 objects, which on a JVM scale isn't very much, but it's like. So there you go. So before and after. So the reason this works better is because effectively I've manually unboxed them. I've said I know these are actually ints, and now compare two ints. Don't go through and use the comparator at the bottom. So yes.
Because shouldn't you just lose the ordered
mixing? Yes, you could, but that's not the only. But then you lose any other if somebody uses min or max or whatever somewhere else. You can't just lose it, but in the end, yeah. And this is actually one of the limitations of AnyVal. There are places in AnyVal where it will box unexpectedly.
Just out of curiosity, this does not emit a warning, right?
No, it doesn't emit a warning.
So is there boxing also in the map call or just above? So lms.map type depth.
I was going to talk about these completely separately. So this is one of my personal bugbears. This first line is completely independent of the rest of the code. So the problem with this line, and you see a lot of this, this is nice functional code, right? Well, it might not be nice functional code, but it's easily parsable, it's understandable. You know, I get the type depth for each element, and then I get the max. But here, it's creating an intermediate collection of depths, and then calling max on it. And you see a lot of this kind of code. And I'm really interested if anybody has any thoughts about how we, if there's a better way of writing this stuff or something, how we change the, if you think about the straw man poll about the 213 collections. Yeah, so folding might, yeah.
You drop down to a lower level functional concept, but it's still
functional. Still functional, yeah, no, but that's, but it's my concern is how do we make this a general pattern, possibly fold, make people use fold everywhere, that's one answer. Fold, can I do that without even doing the boxing though? If I'm, because here I'm still going to create n depths, even though they're a boxed n eval. On fold, because fold takes the object type, I think. Well, it's not an int, it's a depth. It is an int internally, but it's...
.max returns a depth, yeah.
Yeah. So, I'm really interested in anybody who wants to talk to me about this later, about how to make a better pattern for this. Yes?
How did you find it out?
Profiling. So that's the point. Looking at this code especially, you're not going to find out there's a 40,000 plus objects created by inspection, unless you're a better Scala compiler than the Scala compiler.
Okay, so when I'm looking at this, this is like value object, yes?
Yeah,
Scala. So I think a compiler could do this, yes, because in that case I know that I have only wrapped one thing. So whenever inside code I see this or that.
Right. So in this case or in this case? Sorry.
I mean no. When I implement max, yes, inside the value object class, yes. So whenever I see that this and that, yeah. So maybe it is
so
work for compiler to sugar this into wrapped values.
It is. The reason this occurs is because it's a limitation in the current NEVAL implementation.
Okay.
Because effectively the methods with inside ordered are assuming you've got wrapped types. So I think you could improve NEVAL to support this better. So this stuff's, so it's fun.
Would the problem go away if you remove the this equals that, given the fact that order doesn't have to return zero?
Well, this one?
Yeah.
No. It's not that, it's the fact that it's calling this method, so it's calling compare on...
Yeah, but the any val unwraps because you're doing equals on.
Yeah.
I don't think...
Yeah, okay.
The problem is the syntax.
So
actually, what I'm going to do is I'm going to suggest for anybody who wants to discuss this further... I'm going to take this offline because otherwise, well, I'm going to run out of time already, but there's something else I want to, yes, I know. So, get involved, come talk to me, come play. I have a GitHub project which is effectively a clone of the Scala compiler, but I've got a wiki page there with some hints about how to run all this stuff, some thoughts about things that can be attacked. Come play. Future work, things I want to do next, improve the benchmarking. There are already discussions from today have already given me ideas on how to make my benchmark better. I want to do warm compile runs as well as cold ones. I want to try and understand the variance, all that kind of stuff. More optimizations. And the last thing I want to talk about is a larger idea, which is something we've been thinking about for a while, which is the idea of linkings. So the idea of the linker would only work for multi-module builds with dependencies. But the idea is really the fact that if you think about two modules in your SBT project, you've got your main and your test for as a simple case. Now what happens is you compile the main module and then SBT compiles the test module, right? Yeah. Sounds sensible, because the test module depends on the classes and jars created by the main module. But the truth is, you don't actually care about most of the things that come out of that compilation. If we go back to the original diagram, about 40% of the way through the code, we've finished typer. And most of the information I need for compilation of the next step, in fact, once you get to Picolor, I've got all the information I require to compile the files in the next module. Not in a form that I need it in at the moment, but all the information I require, I don't need to write out bytecode, I don't need to write jar files to disk to start the next compilation run. In that case, what it means, if you expose that information early, you can start the parallelization of your second module much earlier. So you go from this, which is a linear sequence, and you cross over. Assume that the red part here is typer. So what I'm saying in this diagram is, once typer's finished, and that's possibly typer and a couple of the other phases, because you do actually need, you probably need up to Picolor, let's say. And there's some talk that those are reorderable to make sure you've just got the information you require. Then I can overlap them all. In fact, in theory, I can overlap the start of the compilation of the next module, the parsing of the files, before the type information is available from typer from the previous run. If you look at the numbers, it would be about 50% faster. Yeah, so...
Is SBT able to look at a compilation process
that... not right now, but I'm hoping to have a chat with Dale and you... Hello. Well, that's the thing. If I can show there's a real huge benefit like this, then you start to think about, do we update the build tools to support it? And the thing is, even if you don't update the build tools, about 5% of typer is unpacking class files to get symbol information out of. So instead of literally parsing class files, and class file formats are not designed to pick out, if you want one piece of information out the middle of a class file, you have to effectively serially parse the entire class file. It's a horrible format for that kind of work. You could extract the information and put it as metadata into the jar file. So instead of loading all the type information, instead of loading all the classes from the jar file, you open the jar file, look for a specific file, and load all the symbol information out in one hit. And I reckon that would save you between 5 and 10% of typer right now. So, and you could just build that into your build process, right? So any libraries you depend on would just provide this information. So that's one of my big thoughts and something I'm going to be looking at. So I'm done. Any questions? And I know we're running a bit short of time, so.
Okay, so from the perspective of the user and someone who actually writes tooling, and this early starting compilation of other modules, maybe it's good, but it also has drawbacks, like let's say that you have some compiler plugin which is introduced after the typer or after whatever
phase, yeah.
Yeah. And you already started build of another 50 modules, but at some point the first module will fail due to this compiler plugin. So another 50 modules compiled correctly, but then you need to fix this first one, and all other modules will compile once again.
So yeah, so with your, to summarize, if you have a build chain that has extra compiler plugins that does extra work after typer, and you start building the downstream stuff early. What happens if that phase then fails and you've got a whole load of build complexity to deal with? It's an excellent question. Theoretically, it's work you've thrown away, right? But it's I don't know.
There's another problem. I mean, this is fine unless you've got incremental compiler that need to decide what to compile at the beginning of the compilation. So you cannot decide in the middle of compilation because prior to compilation, you need to clean the output from the class that you want to compile. And at the before the typer, there is not much done. So I don't think this is actually worth looking at right now. It's like a 2%, 3% maybe at the beginning, just before the typer, namer and parser.
Yeah, the stuff before typer isn't very heavy. So how does this interact with incremental compilation? Well, it means your libraries would load faster, so you'd reduce the load on typer a little, because any dependent jars could pull in the symbol information straight off. Okay. But apart from that, yeah, I wouldn't see a huge.
You can base incremental compilation
with
information, to be honest.
Yeah. So yes, agreed. It might not work for incremental. Any more questions before I'm chucked out? Cool, so I'm at a table tomorrow, I think it's 1 p.m. somewhere next door, if you want to come and chat to me about any of this stuff or anywhere in the conference, to be honest, just grab me, offer me coffee, and come for the hack session tomorrow. If you're interested in hacking on the compiler and want to get started, come and play. Thank you all very much.